Good day, students. In this clip, we're going to be going over two examples on how to solve absolute value inequalities of the form a times the absolute value of x minus h is less than or equal to k. Okay? All right, so before we go over the examples, let's take a look at the possible solutions that you can get, because if you have an idea of what your solutions can be, then you can tell if you're problem-solving process was accurate or not. Okay, so let's say we have the graph y equals k, for example. I mean, y is less than or equal to k. Okay, so this is a situation where you have a horizontal line, and the solution region is all the points that are below that horizontal line. Okay, so let's draw our coordinate system. Let's say this is your y-axis, and then this is your x-axis. And then let's say we have that line, y equals k, somewhere here. So let's put it a little bit lower. So the line y is equal to k, that's the equation of that line. Now, what does y is less than or equal to k mean? So y is equal to k is this line. So y is less than or equal to k is basically this entire region underneath this line, this half plane right here. Any region underneath this line, if this value right here is k, will satisfy this inequality. Okay, so what are the possible solutions we can have? What if you have the absolute, but we can have the absolute value component of the y is equal to ax minus h. We can have it hovering above this region right here, so we can have it look something like this. Okay. All right, so in this case, what I'm graphing is these absolute value components are a times x minus h. Okay, so if you have it in this in this form, how many solutions do you have? Well, the solutions are basically the region on this v that are beneath this line, either on the line or beneath. Okay, so how many points on this absolute value curve is beneath or on this line? Absolutely none. So you can have a situation like this. In this case, you have no solutions. All right. Another case you can have is the situation where the absolute value sits right on the boundary line, something like this. Okay. Now, in that case, what's your solution going to be? Your solution is simply going to be a point, the point where the vertex intersects the boundary line. And then what are you going to have? In this case, the solution is going to be a point. All right, it's going to be a point. And when you graph it on the number line, because in the examples I'll be giving you, you're going to be expected to graph. When you graph it on the number line, it's simply going to be a point. Okay, because only one point satisfies the inequality. So you have one point right there. Okay. And then the last possible case you have is when a portion of the V is in the solution region of the of this boundary region right here. So let's say we have something like this. Okay? Now if you have something like this, guess what the solution will be? The solution is a collection of points that are on the boundary and beneath. Okay? So it's going to include these points right here, these boundary points, and every point beneath. Okay, so this entire region right here projected on the x-axis, that will be the solution to your absolute value inequality. All right, so in this case it was a point, in this case it was nothing, so this is your solution. All right, so in this case your solution is going to be a bounded region, a bounded region. All right. And then you know how bounded regions are. Basically, if you have a line, it's going to be something sandwiched between two points. Since it's equal to here in the inequality, the endpoints will be included. So your solution region will look something like this. All right, a bounded region. So anytime you're solving absolute value inequalities, you should expect to have either no solution, a point as a solution, or a bounded region. These are the only possible solutions you can have when you're solving absolute value inequalities of the form a times x minus h is less than or equal to k. All right? Okay, now in this case, we're focusing mainly on the situation where k is greater than zero. Okay, k is a positive integer. All right, so we gotta keep that in mind, or else it won't work. So k has to be greater than or equal to zero. Okay, so k is greater than or equal to zero. All right, so let's go ahead and try some examples. Take a look at example one. So example one, we have, let's see what we have. We have where to solve graph and check your solutions and check your solutions. Right, so let's say we have the absolute value inequality. Absolute value of x minus 2 plus 2 is less than or equal to 1. All right, so in part one of this tutorial series, we went over how to solve absolute value equations. It's the same procedure. Isolate the absolute value quantity first, and then you can split the equation and solve. In this case, whenever you have less than or equal to, there's a special way where you can solve it by sandwiching the quantity by this number, the number on the right, and its opposite. All right, I'll show you that in a second. So first thing we're going to do is isolate the absolute value quantity. So to do that, we're going to subtract 2 from both sides, and then we're going to have the absolute value of x minus 2 is less than or equal to negative 1. All right, so let's examine what we have here. What this inequality is saying is that a distance, which is what's represented by absolute value, is less than a negative number. Now, does that make any sense? Is it possible for a distance to be less than a negative number? The answer is no, because distances could be zero or positive. It can never be negative. So in this case, we have no solution. All right, no solution here. All right, let's shift our attention to question number two. For number example two, same procedure. We're going to solve, graph, and check. In this case, we have negative 2 times the absolute value of x plus 3 minus 4 is greater than or equal to negative 8. Okay? All right, let's go ahead and solve this and see what we have when we're done isolating the absolute value quantity. So, first thing I'm going to do is add 4 to both sides, add 4, add 4. And then you're going to have negative 2 times the absolute value of x plus 3 is greater than or equal to negative 4. And then we divide both sides by negative 2, divide by negative 2, and divide by negative 2. Now, when you divide by negative, you have to switch the absolute value inequality. So this divides into 2. Okay, so we now see that this form, after isolating the absolute value quantity, is consistent with the situation that we presented in the original problem, right? In the introduction of the problem, where we have less than or equal to situation. All right, so in this situation right here, we know that it could be no solution, one solution, or a bounded region. It has to be one of those cases, okay? So let's determine what this is. Now, what we can do here. Anytime you're solving absolute value inequalities, you're free to sandwich this quantity between this number and its opposite. So I can write this as negative 2 is less than or equal to x plus 3 is less than or equal to 2. This type of combined or sandwich solving process can only be used when you are solving absolute value inequalities involving less than or equal to after the absolute value quantity has been isolated. Okay, you can't do it here because you have other numbers all around, so you can't basically do that. All right, so I separated this plus or minus and I put that there, have it sandwiched. Now, how do you solve an equation of this sort? You're solving two equations simultaneously. 2 is less than or equal to x plus 3, less than or equal to 2. To solve this, what you do is you subtract 3 from all three sides, the less than, the equal, and the greater side. And then your final answer is going to be negative 5 is less than or equal to x, and x is less than or equal to negative 1. All right, so that is your final answer. We have x isolated in the center, and then that's it. Okay. All right, now let's graph this. How do you graph this? To the graph, I'll draw a number line. So there goes your number line. And we're starting from negative five, sorry, all the way to 4, 3, 2, 1, negative one. The endpoints are included. How do we know that the endpoints are included? Because there is a line. This line under inequality indicates that the boundary points are included in the solution region and everything in between. All right, so that's a graph of the solution. Now let's go ahead and do a check. Now to check, how do you check if an inequality solution to an if a solution in inequality form is accurate? Well, to do a check, all you simply do is pick a number that satisfies the inequality. This is a bounded region, so it's very easy to pick a number that satisfies this inequality. So a number that satisfies this inequality could be any number between negative 5 and negative 1. We could pick, how about we pick negative 4, okay? So we can pick negative 4, because negative 4 satisfies it. So let's check with x equals negative 4. What we're going to do is plug negative 4 into the original inequality and see if we end up with a true statement. If we do, then we're confident that our solution is in fact correct. Okay, so we have negative 2 times the absolute value of negative 4 plus 3 minus 4. The question is it greater than or equal to negative 8? Let's simplify. We have negative 2 times the absolute value of negative 4 plus 3 is negative 1 minus 4. Is it greater than or equal to 8? And then this becomes negative 2 times 1 minus 4. Is it greater than or equal to 8? Negative 2 minus 4 is negative. Wait a minute. This is negative right here. Gotta be consistent or it's not gonna work. So negative 8. Negative 8. Minus 2 minus 4 is negative 6. Is negative 6 bigger than or equal to negative 8? The answer is absolutely. So our test number works out, so we're confident that our answer is in fact correct. Okay, so that's that. So thanks so much for taking the time to watch this presentation. Now feel free to subscribe to my channel by clicking here so you can get updates to other cool clips such as this. Please post a comment to let me know what you think about this presentation, and if you liked it, do give me a thumbs up. I would appreciate it. More videos can be found on mathgoodserve.com. Thanks again for watching, and have a wonderful day.